There it goes. All right. Hello, everybody. Hello, that was watching this recording later. Nice to see you. Get the camera there. All right. We're going to wrap this book up today. It's been our companion for a couple of months now. Stars Beneath Us, Finding God in the Evolving Cosmos. We've been on a wild ride. I'm just as Joe went on a wild ride. We haven't had so much the hair-raising encounters that he had, but we've gotten into distant realms of galaxies and scientific ideas and debates with creationism and all sorts of stuff. This chapter, appropriately enough, is called Coming Home. Job comes back home after his encounter with God in the whirlwind, and in a way, it's also just bringing it home, right? Bringing the themes and the things he brought up in this book home. So the first few pages over on page 141 for chapter 10. The first few pages tell about a trip he took to the Okefenokee Swamp with his dad and a troop, like a Boy Scout style troop, when he was a kid.
He doesn't tell us what happened at the end of the alligator.
No,
He said they saw the alligator, and that was all they told us about it.
I
We
mean,
had slithered
they ate
under
the
the.
beer. Couldn't eat the beer. Yeah, that was a joke.
It slithered,
They ate
yes,
the
under
beer.
bank. It slithered as,
Yeah, it doesn't say what happened after
He lived
that.
to
That's
tell
probably
the
the secret
story.
after that.
But he lived to tell the
Yes, he
story.
did.
But yeah, I wouldn't
He
want to
didn't
be
do
that
that.
close to one of those gators. Hopefully, he gives him just eating or something. So he talks about the story of and before the alligator encounter, he's taking in the great wealth of the place, all the creatures. He's also mentions the living silences, so not like the birds or insects that are making noise, but the plants, the trees, and then yes, we get to that alligator on their way out, and the dad is like, "Let's get a closer look," and maybe a little too close, but he says, "Yeah, nothing stood between us and the alligator." That to me sounds like a summary of
Yes.
Job too.
Yeah.
Nothing stood between Job and the world and Job and Leviathan. So then he has that nightmare on the way home where the alligator comes up and eats the deer and pulls it into the ground. And
That's a
that's
modern day Leviathan.
yeah. They've been
That
around a long time too.
was quite a detailed
It was.
description.
Yeah.
The
Vivid
dream.
written. Yes, it was. Yeah. Pulls him down, not into the water, but sinks further and further into the soil on page 144. And then he wakes up to the heavy Atlanta traffic, tired and hungry, but happy. Went on a trip when he got back home. On page 44, down at the bottom there, here's your recap, Donna. Job's cosmic tour is over. The vortex has taken him places few have been, shown him things few have seen, taught him things few know. He has been forever changed by the earth and sky and a host of oddball creatures thriving far from human civilization. Nothing has been missed. Everything from the modest desert grass to the raging Leviathan has conspired to open his eyes. The cosmos has shown him that tradition can sometimes be corrected by experience. I like that one too. I think that would be part of Martin Luther's story too. Tradition can sometimes be corrupted by experience. That sounds like a Reformation. It has demonstrated that God is not a wise man in the sky who sees things more or less like Job himself does. God's admiration for marginal creatures and cosmic chaos has been made clear. And on top of all this, Job has found divine favor. God has praised his borderline blasphemy and condemned his friends for clinging to traditional wisdom in the face of clear counter evidence. The cosmos has shown that tradition can sometimes be corrected by experience. Okay, page 45, the last chapter or last paragraph before the breakdown. I've already expressed my personal distaste for this turn of events in talking about the fifth dentist, right? How at the end, everything goes back to normal, right? Job didn't. Was anything learned? Job gets all his fortunes restored. Okay, maybe tradition does trump experience after all. So he says, I've already expressed my personal distaste for this turn of events. These revised conclusions are hard to shake. It may not be possible in the end to do so. I don't know. Yet I would like to offer another way of thinking about it, a way that saves and even underlines our conclusions. Okay, we'll go back. Here we go. Unbelievably, our fifth dentist, remember Job was the one that was unlike the other four, unlike Proverbs. The fifth dentist knuckles under. The Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he had prayed for his friends, and the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. The Lord blessed the latter days of Job more than his beginning. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. This dramatic reversal of theme of the rest of the book of Job destabilizes our conclusions. Job has, in the end, been rewarded for his righteousness, and in the most obvious of ways. Perhaps tradition trumps experience after all. Apparently, the model of God as supreme patriarch is more robust than we thought. And maybe God is, in fact, primarily interested in rewarding and punishing.
Yeah.
So it comes back to Job, right? People are back in the middle of the story. Job is rewarded. He gets all the riches and everything back. So his explanation for that, he'll kind of state again. He talks about the one detail of Job's daughters getting names and inheritances. That's different. He wishes there were more, but that's different than the rest of conventional wisdom, the other biblical literature, most of it. But he says, you know, he spent this whole book saying it was all about Leviathan, it was all about taking us out of the center, it was all about, you know,
pushing my back.
And then at the end, Job is back.
That's right.
Okay. Pushing my back. You got to take some of the conventional wisdom of the time too,
sure.
Which was it had to be that way.
So, did any of you have to read short stories in school? Like, not a novel, but short
stories? I took a college class called The American Short Story. The whole semester was reading short stories by American authors. Don't ask me what any of them were.
Well, short stories have more of a tendency to leave things hanging, right? They don't have as much room to work, they don't try to tie it in a nice, steady bow. A lot of times they'll leave you kind of feeling uncomfortable or wanting more. And
I kind of liked them because you could read them in a reasonable amount of time.
But sometimes they have that ending that's kind of uncomfortable. Our kids have been reading some short stories in their English classes in high school, and some of them are very dark, very weird. But most people don't like that. Most people like to have it. And now you know the rest of the story, right? Like Paul Harvey, right?
Paul Harvey, yeah.
They want the resolution. They want the bow on the end. So in a way, this was like sticking a bow on the end. You could have just left us uncomfortable, you know, Job. Like, you could have just left it there.
I think I liked the class, but it wasn't because they were short stories.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of them we had to read.
That's true.
There wasn't much time between
them. I got the playbooks.
You get variety, though. Oh, they are cliff notes, I think.
Yeah, they are. Yeah, I mean,
I'm not sure that that's for all these. They
never know. No, but I mean, that's what got through my logic class.
She
might. I have things to do at work.
Next paragraph on 145. Wood and water. For better or worse, I tend to be a purist. I like my coffee black and my wine dark. I also like to keep my religious traditions separate. Nevertheless, when I think of Job's strange denouement resolution, I am unavoidably drawn to a proverb that comes out of Zen Buddhism. Before enlightenment, chop wood, carry water. After enlightenment, chop wood, carry water. I understand this to mean two things. First, enlightened or not, you must do the work that's in front of you. Second, enlightenment does not necessarily change everything you do. Its effects are real, but not always conspicuous. Okay. And then
I interpret that somewhat of being just because you're enlightened, you don't think you're better the next day.
Right.
So it really shouldn't change your outlook on life as far as the rest of the world is concerned. You shouldn't say, look how good I am. I'm enlightened, you know, and I'm better than you, that type of thing. You still gotta do everything mundane like everybody else gotta do.
Yeah, but sometimes if you know the real truth of something, if you're enlightened about something, you have more empathy.
True.
Sometimes people judge things without what was, and here's the rest of some TV show, and here's the rest of the story. I don't remember what it was, but you know,
yeah,
people judge oftentimes without knowing the whole story.
Oh, all the time. And so we wish we had more of Job's story after this. We just get a little. We know he said beforehand, he felt he was like at the top of the pyramid. We've talked about that before. No judgments were wiser. No one was more helpful. People respected him. And then he realizes, oh, I'm not the top dog. But one would assume that once he's restored and gets all his kids back and all his wealth back, he probably goes back to doing the same thing. But now he has a different understanding.
Yeah.
Now he has a mind. Now he's maybe got more empathy for the people at the bottom, now that he has been at the bottom himself.
It may not have changed what he did. It may have.
But how he does.
How he thought
of it.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep. And that's the point he makes here. Let's see. Page 147. In the middle there. His wood chopping and water carrying were distorted by the in addition to's of narrow traditionalism, self-satisfaction, and well-cultivated God complex. Looking back on the good old days from atop his ash heap, he cries, "When I went up to the gate of the city, when I took my seat in the square, the young men saw me and withdrew. The aged rose up and stood." He relished his kingly, godlike status in the eyes of those whom he helped. "I smiled on them, and they had no confidence, and the light of my countenance they did not extinguish. I chose their way and sat as chief, and I lived like a king among the troops, the one who comforts mourners." He's just stating facts, but you can tell he appreciated his position and his influence.
Yeah, he didn't take it by
take it for granted.
Yeah, he didn't take it for granted by that time.
Beforehand, but you can tell there's a little bit of arrogance in there, maybe.
We don't have anybody like that.
He said, "I said this that in an earlier passage, Job challenges God to judge him, and in so doing, betrays the fact that he sees God as a large version of himself. Presuming that the Lord would be as thoughtful as himself in judgment, he says, 'I would speak to the Almighty, and I desire to argue my case with God. I have indeed prepared my case. I know that I shall be vindicated.' But then, afterwards, he is not quite so, well, the author says, I imagine he wasn't quite so high and mighty after this account. One more moment. Still in a position of power, still, you know, giving judgments out, still being generous to the poor, but with a much different attitude. Let's see here. The Bible says we're created in the image of God. Does that mean that God must be created in the image of us? Right? Do we think of God as a big version of us?
You know, I don't particularly like
it. I know. There's a lot of different ways to say it. We create God in our own image. We put God in a box because then nothing challenges us, right? We have control over it. So,
God in a human form.
Okay.
It's never an
act. Well, maybe attributes wise, do you think God acts in the same way that you act? Like you go volunteer at himself, you do things for other people. So is that, you know, God must be like that too?
He's a lot more, he's better at that.
Such an arrogant
statement. You know, it's, I kind of look at God as he's there, he gave us brains, he gave us our physical abilities, and now he's kind of just sitting back and saying, what are you gonna do with it?
Sure.
You know.
Holy Spirit, guiding, nudging.
I think we make a lot of our own mistakes when we out.
Tom Lowe's on the way in here. I was watching something where this guy was at a traffic violation in some kind of sports car. So he was running away from the police at about 120 miles an hour and hit head on into a semi.
Oh.
Now,
I gotcha.
That wasn't God. That was the poor choice that dude made. Sure. That's chaos at work.
Yeah.
If nothing tells you more than that, that does, that you are capable of making stupid mistakes.
Sure.
And special choices. So, you know, it, I don't know where to go with that, but the point being is that
we have
We can, it's not always.
We have our own self will.
Yeah.
And I think it's okay to say that we are created in the image of God, if that image of God is based in scripture and tradition that rings true with our lived experience, as he's been saying. The tricky thing is that I think you bristle against, Roger, is when we say we are created in the image of God, and that there's sort of this unstated other side of the coin, well, because God must be created in our image, God must be because.
So we're created in his image, like when we were in the Garden of Eden, we're sinless. So.
There's a license to steal, as far as I'm concerned. That's
a copyright infringement?
No, that term is a license. Oh, is.
Don't we say that?
Yeah,
the babies are born into sin.
That there's a little bit of gray there in this theology, but yeah, we're born into a sinful world, a world that is broken. We are born into a condition of sin that everybody is in. That doesn't mean that a baby is sinning, right? Where's that line where a baby starts to sin, where they're old enough to understand?
A few things a year ago were in the legal system where children don't lie. That's definitely not true.
They never been a teacher.
But I mean, that was the thing that went around, and children don't know. So if they come in,
you know, it's like putting all in your mouth. I didn't need that.
But they do, and it's inherent. I mean,
yeah, and they can be, and they learn it. And they can be coached to.
Yeah, they know sometimes they're going to get punched if they tell the truth. They get cut lying too.
Well, some parents really got railroaded over that. It's just. The school system, the children don't. Yeah, they do.
Yeah.
Everybody thinks they don't. It's really got a problem.
Sometimes they're more truthful than their parents want them to be, but
they're on children.
Yeah.
I think that statement came about from what I've heard is when children are abused and they tell someone else what happened. Sometimes the parents told them, believe them, or then they say, well, someone else says the children can't lie. Probably where
That could be too.
Bring up one little point about that. To me, at least I was concerned about it. My son was a really difficult child when he was young. To the point where I put him in private school because teachers were afraid of him, that type of thing. And we had to take him to a psychologist and social worker and a bunch of other things. Turns out it was medical. It wasn't environmental or anything like that. But anyhow, make a long story short, I do not particularly like social workers because there are a lot of good doers that don't know what they're doing.
And we've had this conversation.
And the point I'm trying to make is, my son went to a psychiatrist at UVA, and it was an old man my age. They didn't have nothing. It didn't work. So finally, he got one in Lynchburg, and her last name was Looney. I thought that was just gorgeous. She's a psychologist or psychiatrist with the name Looney. But anyway, we was in Roanoke. We had this social worker, and she was doing okay with my son and all that. And she decided to move on to better pastures. So this young lady, about 20 years old, who's got out of school, she's reading this portfolio, and she wants to talk to everybody. I have a problem with that. Son goes in first. My wife goes in second. And I walk into a garage, big time, and it was my fault that he was in shape then because I didn't have any childhood, so I'm not giving him a childhood. Anyway,
I will just say again, don't base all social workers on one bad experience.
I might, but anyway, she wanted me to have she thought I was a little messed up, didn't want to have an appointment with me, and I said, I'm not going to do it. So I left. Lois comes out and says, why is this happening? I said, well, I'll tell you what I'll do. I will compromise. I'll make the appointment and not keep it. That was my compromise. I have no doubt. Just book learning does not get you where you got to go sometimes. You're not better than me.
Well, you're giving me a nice segue here into Galileo, right? How do you handle when authorities see you one way and you see yourself another way, right? And this applies to a lot of what he talked about in terms of what the church had been teaching, what he learned about the church from his experiences at school, and this was the very rigid scholastic theology, and this is how it is, and there's all these structures. It didn't fit with his experience that the dogma was that God is out here and you're here, right? So if I'm gonna use this as a segue, I know it's not exactly what you're saying, but when your experience of trying to help your son get through some things was going one direction with this other person, and then the new person comes in and wants to do something completely different, all of a sudden, that's not fitting what your experience had shown you so far, and now you don't trust anything they have to say. And that has ripple effects to other folks in the same profession. And so if the church and God have been represented to you a certain way your whole life, and that doesn't fit with how you live and your experience of what love is or what mercy is or what the church should be, then it's going to be hard for you to trust the church or religion after that too.
My kids on laugh. They run into my former students, and then their former students will talk about me as a teacher. And my sons are going, "You're kidding. That's not my thing." Perception of my students on it was very different than my own sons.
Yeah. Yes. Well, two very different roles, too.
Right.
You have to send them home, right?
That's
right. And then you went home after dealing with all those kids and had to.
Well, I think what the situation was with me, I was kind of disjointed from the original social worker. I didn't have anything to do with it. It didn't affect me until I was in the middle of it.
Sure.
So that's when it.
Well, that sounds like Job, too, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
It didn't affect you until you were in the middle of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, speaking of Lois had mentioned empathy before, right? You know, we got part of this teaches you empathy for people who are going through something that you haven't been through. Because it's very easy to just look at somebody on the news or in the paper or across the street and be like, well, fill in the blank, you know, this, you know, here's the boilerplate on who they are, but we don't know.
Well, Job was like a lot of people in high places today.
Sure.
I want to say politicians, but not all politicians, you know, people who are chairman of the boards and so forth.
Sure.
They get a little full of themselves.
Well, yeah. Yeah, I can tell some stories, but we're going to finish this book because I can't keep going.
I just listen to the news and you can find your part of that.
Okay, I'll do one story. Oprah Winfrey. Neat person, right? She worked hard. She put in the time. She's built a media empire. Philanthropist, billionaire, does a lot. If you watch her on her talk show back in the 80s, she's sitting there and she's in it with people, right? She's, when she first started, she's, you know, getting to know people and hearing their stories. But now, you know, she puts out her favorite things list every year and she'll say something, you know, so out of touch, like, well, can't people just do this, go to the store and buy it? No, Oprah, they can't. Like, people are hurting, they can't afford that. So, it can change too throughout the course of time. That's one example. And I think Oprah's a neat person, does a lot of good in the world. But I also, you know, if you get up to that upper echelon, it might be hard to remember.
Yeah, she's in a situation. She's in a situation right now where she's trying to do some collateral damage work.
I don't know. She just turned 70.
I know. She was that fire that was in Hawaii.
Oh, that was a misunderstanding.
I don't know.
No, because it was her and the Rock.
Yeah.
And we're trying to set up a fund that if people wanted to donate to help, here's where to donate. They weren't trying to say, we're not going to help you all pitch in the money. It was just said for them. It was just, they were trying to help give people other avenues to raise money. They weren't trying to say, well, you know, you do it.
I think that was, I'm sure we're trying to buy some land too, but that's kind of size of, yeah.
Anyway.
But they have a tendency to be pushy.
This is why Jesus talks more about wealth than anything else. This is why Jesus talks about the rich and poverty and the hungry more than he talks about any of the stuff that most people get up and talk about today. Like.
So do you think he didn't like wealth?
I think he just recognized the temptation and the risks that come with wealth. You know, he tells that one young guy, and he's like, yes, I do love my neighbor, and I do love God. He's like, oh, great. It's like, what else can I do? He's like, okay, well, give away all your possessions and to the poor, and the guy's like, oh, and he leaves sad.
I had a neighbor who they really got into religion and went with and changed the court, and he believed that.
Yeah.
And he'd been a lawyer.
Yeah.
And they gave away everything. I mean, he got rid of his job. He was just going to serve the Lord. Well, in a few months,
that didn't work.
That didn't work. Now that you You've got to help yourself. You've got to keep your job. And
I think he missed the part where Jesus uses hyperbole sometimes.
Yeah, it was a tongue in cheek. I look at it a little bit that way, you know.
But Jesus over and over again says, you know, somebody has no coat and you have two, give one away.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Jesus tells parables about the rich man and Lazarus, the guy who the dogs licked his sores, and Lazarus is in heaven and the rich man is down in Hades saying, please warn my brothers. And it's like, well, if they didn't hear it all this time, they're not going to hear it from me. So it is a consistent theme through the Gospels of Jesus saying, be careful. The rich folks, the folks in power, like the Pharisees, the
Jesus has humor, I think.
His
word tongue cheek said that, I think. He said, well, you know, sort of sarcastic in a way, I think.
Well, I think he was pushing the guy.
Yeah.
If it's not enough to just live by the law and love your neighbors as yourself, that should cover it. But if you want more, okay, I'll give you the next most extreme step. Give everything.
You think you're that great? You're not that great. Try this and see if you can do it.
Jesus talked about that more than almost anything.
It's a necessary evil, I think. So it's...
Well, I don't know if I would go that far, but yeah.
Oh.
It was just lie. It's part of the world.
Yeah.
But what are you going to do with it if you have it? And if that's your only pursuit in life,
why? Well,
build it. You know, I've got all this grain. What am I going to do with it? I'll build more silos. And Jesus is like, no, it's a fool.
It rocks you. Yeah.
One thing we do with Crimson, which I like, we get all kinds of contributions from, you know, $10 to several thousand dollars. But when the financial person puts it out for the monthly meetings, she blacks out who gave the money.
That's good.
So
there's a reason why I'm really thankful that there aren't nameplates all over the building. There's one, I think. A lot of churches will stick, you know, donated buys on everything. And that just, I feel like, misses the point.
Oh, park benches.
Oh, everything. Like, you know, we had a processional cross in one place I served that had a big thing on it given in memory of, by this person in memory of this person. And she felt like now it was still hers.
Yeah.
And she would yell at the acolytes or the pastors if they didn't put on the gloves to handle the brass. So you didn't do that right. It's like, that's why I gave the gift.
Yeah.
We do like the breaks of that.
Yeah.
Some people saints.
Right, but that's different. That's
but,
like,
yeah. Oh, but
yeah, that's not like this door handle.
Yeah,
this door handle was given by Eunice, and this garbage can was given by Bob. Like, it's not like
the couple who paid for this stone.
Yeah.
That was their request.
Yeah. But I think that's the only one in the building.
Yeah, I think so. But I don't know if they had moved by that time or shortly after. Dr. Arnold had been head of communications department at VCU. But they did a lot for this church.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But
so,
blacking up the names like that, if you're doing it to get recognized.
But most people don't even realize there's a nameplate on that.
Probably not. But I was using that as a lease.
In fact, I didn't remember it was there until you mentioned it, but I do know who gave it.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to plunge on because we're going to get this done. Our last chance. All right, page 147, logs on the ash heap. This brings Jesus back into it. Jesus spoke in humorous terms about those who are distracted by, in addition to, you know, what other things do we need to do, you know, to be righteous, besides just carrying your wood and carrying your water, chopping your wood and carrying your water. He says, why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye? In Job's story, loss and the cosmos conspire to remove several logs from Job's eyes. First is traditionalism. Tradition itself is not the enemy. It can help us see things we would otherwise never see. But it may also prevent us from seeing things that are right in front of us. In his telescope, Galileo clearly saw four tiny stars following Jupiter across the sky, and he quickly recognized them for what they were, satellites of the great planet. His colleagues in the Academy, however, refused to admit that Jupiter could have moons. Their traditional understanding of the heavens did not allow for such things. Tradition distorted their vision. Moreover, established ways of seeing things always favor someone, and in this case, it was Galileo's detractors. They had more at stake than whether or not Jupiter had satellites. They had their careers to think about. At the time, university education was based almost entirely on Aristotle, and if the great philosopher was wrong, their whole system of thought and their livelihoods might be at risk. Right? If we change how we do music in church, then is God even real? Like there are for some folks where it's like all connected. And I'm not picking on them. It's just that's how it is. Because it's all interconnected. They got themselves mixed up in it. That was the cost of their traditionalism. That was the log, the in addition to, that prevented them from seeing the obvious. Their self-interest prevented them from seeing moons of truth. Galileo was not distracted. His vision was not clouded by fear and insecurity. When looking through the telescope, he saw the view through the telescope. Like Job, who spoke of God, what was right, as he argued with his friends, Galileo's eyes were logged. Job also left the log of specialness on the ash heap, not in the sense of uniqueness, because each of us is individually made, but in the sense of being separate from and superior to the general run of creatures, both human and otherwise. Self-perceived favorite child is always obsessed with status. Think of the older brother's reaction to the prodigal's coming home party, and the fear of losing it. Job was no different. Chapter 31 is full of Job's claims of moral excellence. He has not been false. He has not been enticed by strange women. He has not ignored the complaints of his servants. He has not withheld from the poor. He has not trusted in his wealth. He has not rejoiced at the downfall of others. Given all this, God, who sees all and who is just, must therefore treat him favorably. Does God not see my ways and number all my steps? Justice demands that the good boy be rewarded. But suffering and the cosmos show Job. That's interesting, right? Suffering and the cosmos show Job that, despite his excellent moral sense, he is not so special. Just like everyone else, he's at risk of falling to the bottom of the social order. It's almost like one of those It's a Wonderful Life type things, right? Mm-hmm. You know, see yourself, or trading spaces where you switch places, you know, see things from the other perspective. Moreover, God shows Job that he not only has no cause to consider himself above other people, but he has no cause to consider himself above other creatures. The wild ass, the ostrich, the vulture, behemoth, and leviathan, these two have a share in the great love of God. Job, finding himself to be one small creature in a cosmos full of them, was able to sit still and let the log called specialness be extracted from his eye. Once gone, he sees the truth. I am of small account. That doesn't mean he's any less loved. It just adjusts his perspective to say that he's no more loved either.
That's like you got a family, you got five kids. They're all different, but you all love them.
Yeah.
So for the who they are, you know, you're not make one over the others.
Exactly. That's why God is identified as a parent so much. Such a perspective soothes many anxieties. Last year, our youngest went through a period during which she grew worried as she lay in bed at night. She fret about the monsters or invisible people or her homework assignments. And so, you know, that goes on a little bit. And so he says, you know, picture them sleeping, going to bed, you know, getting comfy. Think of their closed eyes, their breath, their little bodies. Now they're not different. They're not extra. They're not scary. They're just like you. And that soothes his daughter. And it works for Job, too. The fears are different. Fear of failing one's homework is not the same as fear of not being the best. But the self-obsession driving them is the same. The world came in to focus for both of them when they stopped thinking about themselves and started thinking about something bigger, something else. Unchecked, the idea that you're especially distinguished can grow to the point that God is cast in the image of the creature. Severe distortions of vision can occur when this happens. Perhaps the greatest of these is that the creature comes to believe that they really know something about God. Job, who, pre-calamity, thought of God as a magnified version of himself, certainly thought he had God figured out. That's why he struggled so mightily with his losses. He himself would never allow such an injustice in us. Okay. Are there parts of the church or Christian tradition that you wonder have become logs in our lives?
Oh, tradition.
Any particular part of the tradition that seems to blind us to something going on?
Makes you comfortable.
Oh, sure.
The liturgical church makes you comfortable.
Yeah. And I think
it's predictable.
That's why I change it up a little bit.
We say, when we cite things, do and say things just out of memory without even thinking about the words of them, you know.
That was one thing the church will have a problem with. Is that we're very comfortable. We know exactly what's going to happen. So it's not,
yeah,
it's not No big surprise.
It's not accidental that I do, you know, let's learn the new liturgy. Here's a new song. We'll do the Nicene Creed today, right? When we do hold an evening prayer in Lent on Wednesdays, they do the other version of the Lord's Prayer that we're not used to. And I'm not standing up there saying, like, just ignore that. We'll do the one we're used to. Like, it's okay to
do the Nicene Creed because it was so much longer.
Hey, at least we don't do the Athanasian. That one's like 40. So in a general sense, yeah, if it's just something that's repeated all the time, you know, I can say the Lord's Prayer without thinking. I can be thinking about other things at the same time. And that's why, I think that's why the Protestant denominations and Lutheranism have endured, was because one of our mottos is always reforming. You know, it's not just that Luther flipped a switch and now we're this thing. It's that you keep going back, repenting, introspecting. Are what we're doing, is what we're doing right? Is what we're doing the gospel? And if we don't keep checking in, then yeah, we're just going to be going through the motions.
Yeah, I thought so. He was talking to Luther, church support too.
Yeah.
Churches. Yeah. And they were not used to it.
Right.
And they said, why do you do that? I mean, it just seems odd. They said it seems like it's wasting time. I said, well, partly due to tradition and partially because it's comfortable.
There's other reasons.
Yeah, I know, but I'm talking to this individual, don't know why we do it, because sure. They didn't see any religious reason for it.
Oh,
basically, but get that.
Yeah, yeah.
They were more, you know, the preacher got there just
sure.
Over 30
and
minutes.
You know what? Either thing is good.
Yeah.
Whether it's free form, open ended sermons and singing, and,
yeah.
Or whether it's the liturgical, very structured, both of them are good as long as there's a reason, like the intention behind it. And worship behind it. If you're just doing it because that's how we do it, and there's never a moment, of course, are you going to be thinking of that every single week? Why are we doing this? Well, this is good. No. But if, you know, occasionally you need to stop and check in and be like, well, what does the Kyrie mean? Lord, have mercy. Help me. Why do we share the peace? Because it patches up broken relationships. And it models what we want the world to be when we leave this place. Like, why do we do these things?
I like to see it as being other just passive.
Right.
Like, if you go to listen to somebody speak for an hour, you don't, and you may say amen or something like that.
Sure.
It's a lecture.
I have a hard time with some praise music because I'm not singing. Right? This is for the performers up front and I'm in the audience.
Yeah.
Maybe I can sing along, but for me personally, that's more passive. And I'm not getting as much out of that. On the other hand, for some people, it's like this ecstatic experience almost, right? Like that experience of listening and the song being repeated, and it transports you somewhere. So neither are bad or wrong, as long as you are understanding what you're doing and why.
I have a hard time teaching people who are not used to the liturgical churches what it means.
And vice versa.
One of the things that helps me with the Lord's Prayer, because it does get to be rote after a while. If you think about each phrase, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, is praising, so you can kind of stop and say, or, you know, sing glorified for it.
Yeah.
And then, thy kingdom come, and thy kingdom come. And also, kingdom as well as God, Christ coming again.
Sure.
Give us this day our daily bread, can be. Or give the people in, you know, work to our country, study bread, and you can grow on it.
You can say
it. You can just think about it. It's one way, you know, I can keep my mind on what I'm saying.
I've done something similar to that before with confirmation students when learning the small catechism, right? So don't just say the words, but think of the word as like a little stone being dropped in the water. And then remember what Luther wrote about it as the ripples, right? So that's kind of echoing in your head. You just think, give it more than just the words that you say. Yeah, definitely. And it's good for us to just be aware in general, what are our logs? What do we just take for granted, or what do we add on to that we don't need to do, but we elevate to something important? Page 150 and following tells, you know, This is recapping what happened with Job's family after the fact. His daughters get names, they get an inheritance, both of which were unusual. And then he goes down, bottom of 151, he talks about, it reminds him of a scene in Finding Nemo, in which 100 underwater mines explode at once, and all that is seen on the surface is a single bubble. A small but undeniable expression of deep drama, an easy to miss sign that nonetheless demands an explanation. That's what he thinks of when he thinks of this one small detail about Job's daughters. He wishes there was more, that we got more of Job's story afterwards. But he's saying, you know, there's this one little bubble. I know there's more going on under the surface.
I like the fact that he was the first one who acknowledged the women, you know. Mm-hmm. Well, isn't there's a group called Job's Daughters in some church.
Sounds familiar.
I can't remember what church it is, but somebody I knew a lot of Job's Daughters. And that's if the church, you know, organization or religious organization that has stayed that.
Yeah, I don't know much about it, but that does sound familiar.
Yeah, I can't remember.
That's not a like a Masonic thing, is it?
I was just trying to think. It might, you know, it seemed to me like it was, I don't know, I have to, maybe I have to
look it up and see if I find anything on the internet.
Somebody I know evidently belonged to it, but I can't, and it's been a long time ago.
Page 152, last couple pages. God via flamingo. After coming home from the Okefenokee, resting up, I did pretty much the same things I did before I went. Okay, you still hearing the parallels with Job here? He went on this adventure out in the Okefenokee. He saw all this wilderness, alligators, and got a little scared and had some bad dreams about it. Then got to come home. You know, comes home pretty much the same as he usually does, but something had changed. Like Job's daughter's inheritance, the difference was small but unmistakable and, in a way, unorthodox. I began noticing the birds in our backyard. They were newly interesting to me. My interest quickly grew into a near fixation. My parents encouraged me, buying field guides, recordings of bird calls. I came to know all the species around my house by sight and most by song. I learned about far-off and rare kinds I would never see except in books. In private, I mourned bygone species, the passenger pigeon, the ivory-billed woodpecker, the great auk. Straining for realism, I drew pictures of birds. John James Audubon's Birds of America became my favorite book. Much later, on a clear day, early in my junior year of college, I was passing through the entrance hall of the library, and my forward momentum was gently arrested by the fabulous S-curve of Audubon's American Flamingo. A full-sized facsimile of the great book was on display in the lobby, opened to its most famous plate. As I stood still, looking down at that otherworldly beast, I remembered my own miniature copy of Birds, borrowed from the DeKalb County Library years before. Details of its images came back to me. Strangely large heads of the screech owls, the tail of the sedge wren, held at an obtuse angle to the bird's body, the semi-transparent water through which one could see the large black feet of the trumpeter swan. I wanted to reach through the glass and look long at every outsized page. At the time, I had rejected Christianity for its shallowness and irrelevance. The cosmos had become far more interesting to me. Indeed, a painting of a flamingo had become far more interesting to me than any church or religious organization or anything at all that went by the name Christian. But God called to me through Audubon's flamingo just as surely as God called to Job through the deer, the hawk, and the ostrich. I didn't know it at the time, but as I stood there, I heard the distant roar of the whirlwind, an echo of my day in the swamp. I now know, that through that crazy bird, I was being called toward a faith I could not have even imagined. But right there in the Bible, I had taken to church as a boy every Sunday, Bible that I had studied in high school and even in college, hiding between the books of Esther and Psalms, was a story with the power to change my life. Job celebrates those on the cosmic margins while pointing us beyond traditionalism, beyond anthropocentrism, toward a confounding and essentially mysterious God who is nevertheless known to water the desert grass, admire the constellations, feed the lion, laugh at the ostrich, channel Leviathan's might, and, most miraculously for us human creatures, show up time and time again at the action. So, thinking of our context today, and I've been hearing this from pastors and bishops for a long time, but now one of the first times I've heard it on a real national public schedule, or not schedule, level, that the largest group in America, religious group in America, are nuns, N-O-N-E. Not necessarily atheism, not necessarily agnostic, just non-nothing. No thanks.
Just on me again.
No, no religious affiliation.
That any man.
No. They have very much a religious affiliation. No, just
I don't know them.
Yeah, if right, but they're all around you. So people who don't go to church,
oh, I see,
maybe believe in God, but just no religious affiliation whatsoever. When they take the survey, they check the box that just says none for me.
Okay.
And so that is the biggest religious group in America, right?
And I bet most of them would say, yeah, they believe in God. They just don't see the need to go to church.
Maybe.
They don't. That's what I said, they don't believe in
God. But that's just it. Whether or not they believe in God, they don't belong or believe to any religion.
Right. They must say believe in God.
Okay.
Or the possibility.
I don't know those people.
Yeah.
The people around me that don't go to church, it's just like, oh, you know, I'm watching the TV, or, you know, my grandkids are here that day, or, no, I'm tired, I've worked all week. They say they believe in the same things I believe in, they just have excuses for not going to
church. Oh, I like the term. I don't believe in religion. I believe in spirit.
I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual.
Yeah,
but all of these things kind of boil down to the same, like, after a while, you make excuses enough times, and you just don't go.
Yeah.
And you're like, well, you know, if somebody were to ask you, they might say, well, yeah, I belong to a Lutheran church. Like, my name is technically on the rolls. But
do
I
they
realize
it gets dropped after so many years
maybe,
that you don't go to communion?
But that's just it. So our context, maybe it's not like he was. He's disillusioned with Christianity because he got into science. But fill in the blank. Whatever the reason is that you don't believe in religion, that you don't participate in a church or anything, what is the flamingo that's going to get their attention? What is that thing that's going to all of a sudden speak to them to say, God is up to something else? You know, I'm not saying we need the better marketing campaigns. I'm not saying we need to, you know, come up with the perfect program that'll bring everybody back to the church. That doesn't work. We've tried all of the things. How can we be more authentic with a God who goes to the margins and the ash heaps with, you know, fessing up to the fact that maybe tradition gets a little too comfortable for us sometimes and we need to get shaken up?
Well, I think that's it.
That God's working through the chaos, all the things he brings up in here, that we're not the center of the story, that God loves the creatures too, you know, all these different things that might buck the traditions, but maybe he might speak to people on a deeper level than what we're doing.
I think that's the situation. You know, like the old adage, there's no such thing as a non-believer in a box hole.
Well, sure.
What I'm getting at is that people are very comfortable. When they're comfortable, they're
what do you get?
Yeah, what I'm trying to say is when you're comfortable, you get apathetic.
Christianity grows more in
Yeah.
places where there's war and famine than it does in like the developed, you know,
it was
this group of nuns.
9/11.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody flocked to church
yeah.
even that same day. They had like services.
Religious, not just attendance, but participation, spite. And then it eventually went back down.
But I mean, even like I was agnostic, I was thinking about the situation I was in, and I didn't like the conventional church that was being espoused at that time. It just didn't work. So I'm like, it just didn't work. So, but I wasn't not the type that just was apathetic. I was thinking about it. I just didn't shut
well,
it down.
Here's
but
the difference.
I didn't like what was being taught because it didn't mix with what I was seeing.
Here's the difference, I think. For folks like you, like him, it's more of a, this does not speak to anymore, and I am done.
Yeah.
Right? Most folks, I think it's more of a dimmer switch.
Yeah.
It just gradually fades
yeah.
until you're just not anymore.
They got comfortable. And
or they got comfortable, or the flip side of that was they weren't hearing anything that spoke to their actual experience. The church is a thing that we do. It's a place that we go. The people are nice, but we just do the things. And, you know, after a while, it just loses all meaning. And if it's not actually speaking to your experience and your issues and your problems and your world, then, like he said earlier in the book, then you just gradually give it less and less authority.
Trying to teach Abby that she can talk to God anytime.
Yeah.
You know, that he's with her. I gave her a little book. It's called Say a Little Prayer. Mm-hmm. And each page has something, you know, real simple, like while you're brushing your teeth, think about your day and ask God to be with you. And so I was sending her a little clip like that every day with text, and I asked her what she would, you know, look at the book, because we have the same book, and pick out one that she liked, which she never did. But anyway, last night, when I don't know if he told you, but they lost their dog last night.
Oh, no.
Yeah, they had to put on a sleeve, so, you know, kind of the arm running her, and I said, you know, God knows how much you hurt. So I'm just trying to bring it in to her day, he tied it in the truth. And, you know, I think that's important. That's one of the ways I think that we can speak to other people, you know, talk to them about it. You know, God knows what's going on in life.
Well, that's going to be our reading on Wednesday this week. When you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who go out on the street corner like, I'm praying, right? That's not what it's about. But just by modeling, I want to be interacting with God all the time. In my hurts, in my teeth brushing, in my celebrations, I'm going to pray to God. I'm going to be praying thanks. I'm going to be praying for help. You know, and I'm going to know that God is listening and God is knowing me. That's a really strong witness and testament. It might not make sense to her now, but at some point it might have that epiphany, that light bulb go off of, oh, this is what she was talking. But no one's going to know that unless someone is there to teach it.
I did send her one day that I think helped. They were having some issues. And I sent her a said, if she go back, and she said, thanks, I need that.
Yeah.
And so that, you know, I feel so maybe I should keep on.
Sure. But, and it's not just that you're saying, here's words.
Mm-hmm.
You are also sticking with her and checking in on her and responding to what's going on in her life. So I think that's why sacraments are bread and wine and water, not just ideas. I think that's why Jesus is the Word made flesh and not just a teaching. God knows that we need it to become real. So you are making it real for her. And that's, I mean, when we talk about sharing the gospel, it doesn't necessarily mean being Paul and writing letters and making speeches. It just means living the gospel, whether that's forgiveness or peace or, you know, whatever it is, offering generosity, you know, the stuff we practice in worship. Worship does have a meaning. We carry it out to our lives. I mean, it's got to have some meaning to it, or we're going to grab people, somebody pays attention.
So I'll need to go on.
Okay, I'm gonna
try
yeah. I'm gonna close with just this last little bit again.
Okay.
Job celebrates those on the cosmic margins while pointing us beyond traditionalism, beyond anthropocentrism, towards a confounding and essentially mysterious God, which a lot of people don't like, who is nevertheless known to water the desert grass, admire the constellations, feed the lion, laugh at the ostrich, channel Leviathan's might, and most miraculously for us human creatures, show up time and time again at the machine. So I know this book is going to stay with me for a while. There's going to be certain things that you'll probably hear echoes of in my preaching and other things that I picked up from this or heard put in a certain way in this that really stuck with me. But I hope, despite whatever parts you liked and whatever parts you didn't, I hope you guys got something out of this.
Yeah, I got a almost can you read it all again, just so sort of,
yeah,
read it all together.
Yeah. And all at once is spread out over.
Legitimizing.
Good.
It legitimized my way of thinking to some degree. Up to that point, I thought I was kind of stuck out in left field from everybody else. And I still probably am, but it helped legitimize my situation. So
sure.
I'm not the only one in the bucket.
It threw you a can with a string on it.
Yeah,
now we could at least talk to each other.
Yeah, I'm not the only one in that bucket.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Thanks for those at home. We're going to get into the book of Philippians.
I certainly enjoyed it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks for all the conversations,
stories,
questions.
I remember that. Yeah,